Well, welcome everyone. I'm David Coates at Dartmouth in the Institute for Security, Technology and Society. And it's my pleasure today to host this panel of distinguished guests from around the university and industry related to privacy implications of the Internet of Things. And I'm gonna start off by just giving a very quick introduction to what is the Internet of Things and maybe what are the privacy issues very briefly, so we can spend most of our time hearing from them. And then at some point, I'd love to have your questions. So we really wanna hear from the audience. That will be possible in the chat. You can type your questions there. And when we get to that point, I will read those out for the panelists. So let me just share my screen here a little bit. And as I mentioned, we're hosted today by the Institute for Security, Technology and Society at Dartmouth, and also by the SPLICE project, an NSF-funded multi-university effort that just kicked off this last fall to address privacy and security in smart home contexts. So what are smart things? What are the Internet of Things? I like to think of different use cases. For example, smart environments would include smart homes. We're all familiar with the advent of the gadgets that are making our homes more smart, if you will, by adding computation and internet access to a lot of everyday things. Smart buildings more generally, which could include office buildings, and of course, smart offices. People are starting to augment office spaces and meeting spaces with smart technology to enable more effective business meetings. Smart malls, there are even shopping malls now that add a lot of smart features that enable a better or more efficient or more enjoyable shopping experience. Smart schools, bringing technology into the school with the students or with the teachers to enhance and increase the learning environment. Smart school buildings, so of course the buildings themselves might also have some smart features here, focused this diagram on infrastructure type things like air conditioning and power management. And smart cars, of course, you're hearing now about autonomous vehicles, but even those that are not autonomous have increasing numbers of computers in them and internet connections that enable other kinds of services. So these are all examples of smart environments, which I think of as a subset of the Internet of Things. And I looked around and couldn't find any one consistent, widely used definition of IoT, of Internet of Things, but here's what I use. To me, the Internet of Things is a vision. It's an idea in which a wide range of everyday objects become smart things by adding digital electronics and a network interface that allows them to talk to each other and to the internet. For example, a very common example these days is the Amazon Alexa service that you can access through an Amazon Echo smart speaker. And there's a device in your home, it has a network connection, and it talks to an Amazon service somewhere across the internet. So smart things come in a lot of different types and sizes. I see them as sort of the defining characteristic is that they usually have some ability to sense their environment or to affect their environment. For example, they can listen to audio and then they can speak back, or they can sense the temperature in the room and adjust the furnace to heat your house. They may or may not have a human interface. So the interface might be a touchscreen, or it might be video or audio, or maybe none at all. It might just simply be embedded in the wall and taking care of managing energy. It might be very, very small, like something you could wear, or something mid-sized, like you might put on a tabletop, or really large, like a refrigerator or a washing machine. All of these things are smart things. They may be stationary, like a refrigerator usually is, or they might move around. They might even leave the home and come back, or actually go from environment to environment, home to school to office and back. And they may be battery powered and therefore very energy limited, or they might be just plugged in and have essentially unlimited energy. And so this is a very wide design space in which these operate. And then the smart environment is a space, to me, is a space where these things interact with the environment, sensing the environment, maybe affecting the environment, interact with the human occupants of that environment, sensing them or receiving requests from the occupants. And then because they're internet connected, they can connect to other internet-based services to check the weather or to order a product, or to upload a video for remote use. And of course, these things and the people in them can, people in the environments can come and go, right? So back in the day when we used to leave our homes, remember, and go to school, you might leave with some of your smart things and then come back later with different smart things. So this kind of environment where people live and work and learn raises privacy questions. And so to my mind, when I'm thinking about privacy, I want to know whose privacy do we care about and who might be trying to violate that privacy. So on the left, I have stakeholders, people who have a stake in privacy. And the most obvious is the owner of the space, the homeowner, or in some cases, a landlord, for example. And occasionally there's a separate party who is an operator. So somebody might own a shopping mall, and then they contract out the management of the smart things in that mall to an operator. And then of course, other people work there and yet other people shop there. And those others are occupants, some of whom may live there or work there. Some may be short-term visitors, or in a smart school might be students or employees. And all of these people and parties have a privacy interest, but they differ. And that is often where the challenges lay. And on the other side, if you will, are the adversaries, parties who have some either intentional or unintentional impact on the privacy of the stakeholders. So the most common example is sort of the hacker type who is somehow breaking into your smart home or your smart office in order to steal information from you or spy on you. But sometimes it's actually not a third party, it's a second party. It's the thing manufacturer. So the vendor of the product itself that you've put in your home or your office might itself be causing a privacy concern by using or misusing the data that it collects. And then of course, the thing owner might actually be an adversary. If I own a home and put up a camera on the outside of my home facing outward, but I'm actually capturing video or audio of passersby, then I might be invading the privacy of those people. And then of course, other occupants. So if this is an apartment complex, then I might actually be collecting information about my neighbors, or if I have a guest or a domestic worker come to my residence for a period, their privacy might be impinged by the things that I have in my home. Maybe without even being aware of it, they may find that. So there's a very rich space here. And that's why I'm really glad today to have this excellent group of colleagues. And I'm going to ask each of them to briefly introduce themselves and to talk just a little bit about what they see as some of the privacy implications for the Internet of Things. And then after we've gone through all of them, we'll come back around and look for your questions. So we'll start with, we'll go alphabetically, I guess. We'll start with April.
Thank you so much, David. So my name is April Doss, and I'm an attorney by training. And stumbled into data-driven technologies and the privacy issues relating to those kind of accidentally. So if there's anybody on the call who's thinking, wow, these topics are really interesting, but I think of myself as more a liberal arts kind of a person than a technology person, know that there is a really important role in some of those ethical issues, the privacy issues, the legal and policy issues that David already touched on for people who are not technologists as well as people who are. So after getting out of law school, I worked in a variety of jobs and then went to work at the National Security Agency, where I spent 13 years. I was worked there in a variety of capacities, leading technology development efforts as a non-technologist, but as a manager. And also worked in the General Counsel's office, where I was the head of intelligence law, providing legal advice on all of NSA's technology development, intelligence operations, privacy and civil liberties programs, and oversight and compliance. And in early 2016, I came out of government to move into private practice and look at privacy and security, data security issues from a consumer protection perspective, from the perspective of things like protection of critical infrastructure, but again, in the private sector context. Went back into government to go down on the Hill as the senior minority counsel for the Senate Intelligence Committee's investigation on Russian interference into the 2016 election. So spent a lot of time looking at things like foreign influence operations that make use of personal data and other kinds of threats like that. And I'm currently, as the slide indicated, back in private practice. So, and I've also written a book, Cyber Privacy, Who Has Your Data and Why You Should Care. And the goal of of that has been to speak to exactly these issues as data-driven technologies really have proliferated in the last 20 years. In terms of the Internet of Things specifically, a lot of what I've looked at have been issues relating to use of IoT devices in an education context. What does that mean in terms of student privacy versus school surveillance? Internet of Things in an employment context, whether that is an RFID, chip embedded in an employee badge or recording of all kinds of metrics about human behavior by the workforce in the workplace, or what we're seeing in both employment and education during COVID, where there's sort of this fuzzy boundary now between work and non-work or school and non-school environments, and all of that data is made more available to employers and schools. So I'll stop there because I've already talked a lot, but I'll just say that, if you think about the way that technology has changed in the last 20 years, it is extraordinary to see this convergence of national security, personal privacy, consumer interests, corporate challenges, all the things that relate to speech platforms, information operations, all really converging. And on the one hand, we all love the convenience of all these great new technologies and the capabilities they provide. And it is challenging to keep pace with the privacy implications and understand what really those mean.
Indeed. Yeah. Thank you, April. Amit?
Hello. Thanks for having me. I'm Hamad Adade. I'm faculty at Imperial College London. I also work at Brave, the privacy-focused browser. So my interest and my expertise has been mostly around networks and systems. So I've worked on putting sensors on wind farms back in the days, on sheep and moving animals, looking at childhood obesity and various issues where you need some sort of mobile sensing or sensor networks. In the last few years, I've been focusing on privacy preserving analytics and how to do this sensing and data analytics while respecting individuals' privacy. This is in a couple of areas, including, for example, recommender systems, or specifically recently we have been working on a pretty large scale project on use of smart home devices and IoT devices for monitoring patients, for example, who are suffering, for example, from conditions like dementia. So we have quite a big project here. So in the last 5 years, I've been working on an open source platform to enable this, and we now have quite a huge consumer IoT testbed at Imperial, which is actually, there's a mirror of it also at Northeastern University with my colleague, Dave Chofness. So we are hoping to engage more also with the Splice project on that matter. But we are looking at generally, what are these devices doing? How can we automate interactions with them? Where does the data go from them? What kind of updates do they receive? And generally a number of things that can go wrong by having all these devices in our households. And even in my own home, I have about 40 random smart home devices. So, and my postdocs and students have access to the data from them. So, I'm kind of doing some sort of extreme quantified self. I'm sure there's going to be some media disaster in the future. But I think I'll stop there. Thanks.
Yeah, just don't run for president, Hamid, with all that data out there. Oh, great. Okay, Susan.
Hi. So I come to this, my name is Susan Landau, and I come to this with a fairly unusual background because I was in academia. I started off as a theoretical computer scientist, and I taught at Wesleyan, and then at UMass. Then I went off into industry for a long while. I spent 11 years at Sun. I worked briefly at Google. In between, I was briefly back in academia at the Radcliffe Institute and visiting Harvard for a year. Then I went to WPI, Worcester Polytech, and now I'm at Tufts. And in this long journey, I've switched areas. I used to prove theorems about fast algorithms, and now I write law review papers about security and privacy. And I also do technical papers as well. So the flip happened in the mid 1990s when I began writing on encryption policy and somewhere, and then I went to Sun, and somewhere in the middle of all that, I discovered I'd become a policy wonk, but a policy wonk with some technical chops. So the things that I'm interested in are wiretap and encryption policy and surveillance, and I've been working on that for about 25 years. One of the aspects of that is thinking about communications metadata. When you make a phone call, the data that the phone company keeps is what number was called, what number did the calling, how long was the call for, what day did it happen, what day and time did it happen. And you'd be surprised, but it turns out even that minimal information, don't even include location, which happens with a cell phone, but even that minimal information can reveal such things as that somebody is thinking of having an abortion or has had an abortion, that somebody's heart monitor isn't working right, things of that aspect. And so when I think about the Internet of Things, knowing when somebody's coffee maker turns on tells you a lot about their schedule for their days. You can even learn, for example, from electricity use, what devices are working in their home at a particular time. So that's one piece of what brings me to Splice. The other piece is that when I worked at Sun Microsystems, I worked on best practices for something called the Trusted Platform Module. This was a hardware root of trust within devices. It's in your laptop, it's in desktops, and so on. And on top of this secure piece of hardware, you add software and you verify that the software is correct, that you've got the right operating system from the company, and so on and so forth. When we were working on it, there was a great deal of concern whether the laptop owner, if for example, you were working for a company and the owner was the company, but you were the user, whether the company could spy on a user, whether companies could prevent people from downloading copyrighted material. This was back in the 2000s when there was a lot of fuss about copyright. And so we came up with a set of best practices that weighed competing values of privacy, security, interoperability, portability of data, controllability, and ease of use. And one of the things that I'm thinking about at Splice is a similar set of best practices for Internet of Things activities. And there it's quite complicated because all of these are important, and how do you balance? So that's what brought me here.
Great, thank you, Susan. All right, Avi.
Hi everyone, my name is Avi Rubin and I'm a computer science professor at Johns Hopkins University. I'm also the technical director of our Information Security Institute. I'm going to talk a little bit about smart homes and smart devices, but one particular angle that I'm interested in right now, along with many other problems that I find interesting. If you think about your smart home, in addition to things that are part of the house, like you might consider the doorbell, the thermostat, you also have other smart devices like smart refrigerators, and I've seen a smart meat thermometer, and people joke about the toaster, the coffee maker, etc. And there's something else that kind of falls into that category, which would be home medical devices. So if you think about it, up until recently, pretty much the only home medical device was a thermometer. Every parent would take their kid's thermometer, and that would be one thing. But they weren't really good at doing anything else. For example, if you thought your kid might have strep throat or an ear infection, or if there's a rash on their skin, pretty much you're going to take your kid to the doctor, even if it's 3 a.m. And anyone who's raised a bunch of kids, I had raised 3 of them, knows that those ear infections always happen at the worst possible time. And the thing is, if you talk to doctors, they'll tell you that many times it's actually not an ear infection. But for many pediatricians, it's just easier to give you antibiotics because that way, if it is an ear infection, it'll cure it. And if it's not an ear infection, well, it probably won't hurt you. But the thing is, that there's an overprescription of antibiotics, and that's actually not a good thing to give people that when they don't need it. And so I've had a look recently at one particular smart device, and I'll talk about how these fall into the context of smart homes and smart devices, but this particular one is called an otoscope, and there's a group that's building one of these at Johns Hopkins, and I've learned since then there are 4 or 5 competing companies that are doing pretty much the same thing. This is a device that goes into your ear, just like you might have seen in the past where the doctor takes a look into your ear. But this one has a nice camera and some AI capabilities. And apparently, it can predict with more accuracy than most pediatricians whether or not an ear has an infection in it. And so imagine a device that you could buy for, say, $100 that you could have at home that would save you all those middle of the night trips to the emergency room. So one of the things that's happened, in particular, I think COVID has really accelerated this, is a move towards people doing telemedicine and home diagnosis. And I think that this is pushing a lot of medical device manufacturers who make personal use medical devices that you could have in your smart home and would be part of your smart home network to proliferate. And if you think about that, well, that will introduce some more security and privacy problems than you would have had if you didn't have medical information traveling on your home network. And so these devices will include technologies like Bluetooth and Wi-Fi and smartphone apps and cloud services. And in addition to all the issues we care about with all our other devices, we have to think about HIPAA and FDA regulations. In addition, these medical devices will be operated by lay people, and they may not understand exactly how to do everything that needs to be done, and they'll be connected to medical portals. So some of the questions we have to ask is, how do we protect this medical information, which could be on a not very secure home network, and how do we deal with consumers who may not be that tech savvy or aware of privacy laws or medically trained? Maybe a question that's not for us to deal with, but society will have to deal with, is how will the medical establishment adapt to the computer-based diagnoses? And then for us, what are the new threats and attack surfaces that these consumer medical devices will bring? So I think that this is a special case of a general case of a problem that we're working on in Splice. And I wanted to introduce that to you and be happy to answer any questions during the Q&A.
Great, thanks, Avi. Thanks, all of you. This is, fascinating set of backgrounds and a fascinating set of points. I want to remind people that we'll be taking questions in the chat. And since a couple of people mentioned it, I just thought I'd put, if you're interested in the Splice project, Susan and Avi and I are part of that project. You can learn more about it there or follow our work there. We do have one question that I came in early, and I'll go ahead and read that and see if who would like to respond. Market forces have led major software makers to pay more attention to security issues, but customers still have little or no legal recourse against negligent vendors. You can sell appliances that bear, for example, the UL seal of approval, yet are completely open to remote perpetrators of havoc. And you can put spyware into all kinds of devices. So the question, do panelists foresee or advocate any regulatory framework, roles for professional societies, for example, through lobbying or through the administration of codes of conduct, or other social mechanisms that might mitigate the situation? So does anyone want to comment on this? See any regulatory frameworks, roles for professional societies, or other social mechanisms that might mitigate the situation? April?
Yeah, I can speak some to the regulatory framework. You know, it's such a great question, and it's a really tangled and complex environment to try to regulate. So if you think about the SolarWinds hack that we've all been reading about since mid-December, it's a great example of how complicated the software and hardware ecosystem for most organizations is. And so for those not familiar with it, the sort of Reader's Digest version is that SolarWinds makes some networking equipment that had some corrupted code that was launched by cyber actors, malicious cyber actors, as part of a supply chain attack. And then that malicious code was uploaded to users of this particular product over the course of some months before it was discovered. And the estimates range from hundreds to thousands of organizations and entities that have been affected by it. So if you think about the way this proliferates outward, according to SolarWinds SEC filing, some 18,000 customers might have been affected by this malicious code that was uploaded. That's 18,000 organizations who then may have had further penetration by these same malicious actors. That penetration could have affected all kinds of people. Ordinary individuals whose data is held by a company that uses this technology, government departments and agencies who have been affected by it, and so forth. So trying to trace back for either a liability purpose to figure out, you know, is it possible for an individual to sue SolarWinds, right? Or from a regulatory perspective, how do you impose those obligations? It's a really kind of knotty thing to pick apart. There are some standards that have been set by standard setting bodies for certain kinds of cybersecurity considerations. So the ISO 27001 standard is, you know, sort of the one that comes to mind, and NIST, the National Institutes of Standards and Technologies, has issued a lot of guidance. So far, most legislatures around the country have shied away from taking any approach that requires specific cybersecurity measures or specific cybersecurity outcomes in terms of liability protections. There's a few exceptions to that. So one notable, so many states in their data breach laws say that if there's a breach of consumer data, consumers have to be notified. And there's a whole bunch of details around when and how and whether the state attorney general or other people have to be notified. But they, most of those do not allow individuals to sue. And the complexity here is, so an organization gets breached. Maybe it's a retail company. Maybe it's a local mom and pop restaurant. Maybe it's an online, you know, customer-facing web-hosted company. They may have been suffered some kind of cybersecurity incident and data breach because they were behaving negligently or even recklessly with respect to security. Or they might have been the victim of a crime from a really well-motivated criminal actor who found their way into their system. And this is the tricky thing around the liability piece. And one of the reasons why regulators have shied away from imposing liability for data breaches. It's very often in the ordinary run of a data security incident and a data breach incident, often hard to get to attribution on precisely who was responsible and precisely how the incident occurred. Depends on what kind of logging and other information is available. It depends on a lot of things. But it's often hard to know whether the company was truly negligent or merely the victim of a crime. And sometimes it's a bit of both. So there are some exceptions, as I said, and I'll mention just two of them. In New York, the Department of Financial Services issued regulations that impose very specific cybersecurity obligations on any financial services entity licensed in the state of New York. So think about, you know, banks and insurance companies, insurance agents, everybody who's in the financial services industry. This regulation was passed adopted a couple of years ago and was really groundbreaking because where most states in data breach laws say things like you have to take reasonable measures to protect data, this provision said you have to take specific steps. You have to have training and you have to think about multi-factor authentication and you have to consider encryption and you have to have a cybersecurity policy and program and a whole bunch of things that are all best practices, but generally not required as law in most cases. So that's one example of imposing some very specific restrictions. It still doesn't create a private right of action. In California, under the California Consumer Privacy Act, which took effect in 2020, there is a private right of action for data breaches that affect California consumers. Because that law is still so new, although a number of class action cases have been filed, we haven't seen a lot of that litigation really sort of play out to its full conclusion. But again, going back to the first point, almost anybody who has any kind of information is using a complicated set of devices made by different companies, services and support provided by different companies, and it's not always easy to tell whether fault lies with a particular device maker, with an individual using the systems and devices, with some set of protocols or processes, and it can get very hard to untangle how regulation might be most effectively applied. It's a really important question, as data gets stolen every day for all kinds of purposes. It's a really important question, but it's not a straightforward one. And it's something that I think we'll continue to see state legislators and at the federal level see folks looking at, probably as part of proposals for a federal data breach law and or a federal privacy law.
Wow, that's great. A great question and a very thorough answer. Thank you, April. That was awesome. It makes me think more about how we need better forensics to understand what happened when a breach happens, right? In particular, if there are devices involved, non-traditional computer devices, we'll need to be able to reproduce or reflect on what happened and maybe help with attribution. So we have some other questions coming in. This one is for Susan. How do you feel about the fact that IoT devices, phones in particular, but others too, enable law enforcement agencies to secure geofence warrants that may violate the privacy of individuals who inadvertently happen to be near somewhere when a crime was committed?
So we've been using such kind of information, for example, from cell towers to collect information and say, ah, this phone was here and here and here when there were bank robberies at each one of those bank robberies, and then get a warrant to actually search the suspect's home. When you collect the data of lots of people to then figure out which one was the individual, it is useful to, you need all the data, but then you have the individual. The point is that you should not then, or law enforcement should not then, store the data of everybody else. You can provide, of course, technical protections to make that happen by doing secure multi-party computation and so on and so forth, although we haven't figured out how to do that at scale at a way that actually works. So what you do want, it seems to me, is to have the legal protections that say that data can be collected, but it can be used only for that purpose and not stored by law enforcement. Enforcing that, of course, is complicated, but it's also very similar to contact tracing apps. So I've spent the summer and the fall writing a book on contact tracing apps that'll be out soon. And contact tracing apps, they're the kinds where the data is centralized, the kinds where the data is decentralized. Decentralized means that if Dave and I both have the app running and it turns out that I get sick a day, or I discover I'm sick a day after I've been near Dave, my phone uploads information to a central server, which Dave's phone then collects, and he learns that he's been exposed without learning who it was who exposed him. Centralized would mean that the data of our interaction would actually have been exposed to the central authority. So the decentralized apps allow the sharing of exposure information without exposing the privacy of the interaction. Now, learning about people's proximity is a very private piece of information. Who's spending time with whom? It's important for journalists to have privacy when they're talking to sources, but it's important. Many of us go and see a friend who maybe our spouse doesn't particularly enjoy our spending time with, or our parents don't enjoy us spending time with. There are many times that proximity information is simply, should be ours and ours alone. So the question is, what happens with the kind of information that comes from contact tracing apps? Well, it should be information that is used for the purpose of controlling the spread of the disease, and it should not go further. Much of the way April was talking about the, but earlier I was hearing conversation about 23andMe and the data from there. So the question is, what purpose is the data being collected for, and can we limit it to that purpose? Now, we've always had the problem in law of function creep. That is, we allow a certain kind of collection of data and then we expand the collection of data. But here I would say the geofencing, if you're collecting the data for a specific purpose for which it is a reasonable collection, then yes, then go ahead. But you have to ensure that the data is then not repurposed for another function.
Very good. Thanks, Susan. And this kind of gets me to the next question for Hamid. And it's a shorter question. Is my TV spying on me, and how would I know?
So we've done quite a lot of experiments on smart TVs and smart home assistants, and we have quite a few of them. There's actually one right by me, a few meters away. The answer has been that data is leaking from the TVs, sometimes, unfortunately, without the manufacturer's knowledge. So, for example, we had a couple of cases that the manufacturer of the TV was actually not aware that the apps, the range of apps that come pre-installed with the TV, they're making a connection to their app provider on every turn on and every event that the TV had. We informed the manufacturers, and then they apparently updated that. We haven't retested the equipment yet, But there's quite a few of these incidents that we've benchmarked, and we've run extensive experiments trying to, for example, we've played hundreds of hours of audio to smart speakers and all of that, and we've seen like tens of activations daily on these devices. So I'm not saying that they're always intentional by the manufacturer, but there have been definitely cases that there's been data collected either by the apps or by the microphone on these devices.
And what do they use that data for? I mean, what's their motivation, and why should or should I be worried about it?
Well, there's a bunch of there are reasons that you can no longer, in a way, buy an unconnected TV or an unconnected fridge soon, or a washing machine, which is the manufacturers like to understand the usage trend of people in different areas, different neighborhoods. For example, whether it's a washing machine or a TV. So they want to see at what time of day, what type of channels are you watching, for how long, how often do you switch the channels? And maybe in terms of hearing the conversations, there are always patents being filed. For example, some of the manufacturers, they have patents around understanding our mood or emotions or well-being from the voice that we have when interacting with devices. But not everything has been made clear in terms of they don't clearly come up with it. Unfortunately, with a lot of IoT devices, the model today is this eat as much as you can data. Let's collect it while we can, and then we will see what happens with it after. In the EU, there's a little bit more regulations and standardization effort in terms of GDPR and ENISA, and which is the European Cybersecurity Agency, and ETSI, and also UK's Center for Data Ethics Innovation. They're coming up with more guidelines and regulations that are enforceable, but we are yet to see a major enforcement.
You wanted to comment?
I can as well. So I think that was a great description by Hamid of what some of the legitimate, not in a moral sense, but in a technical sense, collection of information is. But there's also the fact that many of these TVs are running Linux or some other operating system with security problems. And so these things can be compromised and collect a lot more than what the manufacturers are collecting via apps and more than just your watching habits. For example, a lot of TVs now have a microphone in the remote that's used to control the TV, and it's possible that that could be used to listen in to what was happening if an adversary controls all the firmware in the device. And I just want to recall a funny thing that I heard Adi Shamir say at RSA once, so I'll give him credit for this idea, but he said, imagine, and this is maybe relevant in a couple weeks, that you're having a big Super Bowl party and you buy this large TV and you're going to have all your friends over for this event that's going to happen in real time in a few minutes. And as the Super Bowl is about to start, on your screen comes a message saying, send this many Bitcoin to this address or you will not be able to use your TV again. So they basically ransomware your television. And I think that applies to a lot of IoT devices that we are even more dependent on than we are on watching our TV during the Super Bowl.
I think it depends on how big a fan you are of the teams in the year's game, Avi. But I know my furnace would be something I'm very dependent on here in New Hampshire. Let's see. So keep those questions coming in. This is great. Here's one. Probably anyone can take it. Are firmware updates to devices important in keeping the device secured? Or another way, should you check before upgrading your firmware what's actually included in that update?
I can start with that one.
Bobby? Sure.
Firmware update is a very interesting question because some manufacturers take the position and implement the technology that a device will just update itself completely transparent to the user. So these devices will just constantly be getting new updates. Some manufacturers will take an extreme that everything has to be approved by the user, and it's actually also common to see kind of a hybrid approach where certain important updates happen in the background, like I know the Tesla cars do this, and yet occasional updates with new features, the user's given a choice. And I put it in air quotes because while you cannot update it, you're going to get very behind as more updates come. And in order to get the full functionality of many devices, you really do have to update. I don't think that users in general are in a position to be able to evaluate and make a determination as to whether or not to apply an update, because what happens is the manufacturers put out a chain of updates. And so you can't just pick and choose and say, well, I'll take that update and I won't take that update. And usually the latest update will automatically include all of the previous updates that that manufacturer gave that you might be missing. So I think it would be nice in theory to be able to decide what you want to do with your IoT devices, but if you have 40 devices like Ahmed in your house and they're all updating, you're not going to be able to sit around and make individual decisions about what to update and what not to update.
Hey, yeah, and that's one I faced personally several times. Here's back to the law enforcement question or legal issues. I'm curious about what the panelists think about IoT being used as a tool of state repression of social movements. With the advent of new domestic terrorism laws, can IoT be leveraged for this type of surveillance and subsequent criminal charges against those defined as being terrorist or un-American? For example, the Wall Street Journal broke a story about feds buying commercial data and skirting warrant requirements.
So I'm sure that April and I both have answers. Do you want to go first or should I go first, April?
Why don't you go, Susan?
Okay. So my short answer is that if there's warrant requirements for obtaining a certain type of information, it shouldn't be legal for government investigators to be able to obtain the information in other ways. I'm not a lawyer, so I'm not gonna be able to phrase how the law gets stated, but we've had the problem for a long time, and the Wall Street Journal article pointed it out in a particular example. But for many years, the Privacy Act prevented agencies from collecting certain information, but they could buy the information. Now with the plethora, the wealth of information we have about individuals, the problem has become more acute. Does the US government need a new privacy law? That's been true for a long time. There's now pressure from Europe that the US should develop a new privacy law. Otherwise, there will be less data sharing with the United States in the form of companies like Microsoft and Yahoo and Google and Facebook and so on. Will have to store data abroad and not use the data here. So there's industry pressure and European pressure on the US to pass a new privacy law. And I suspect that will actually happen under the current administration. Whether it includes these aspects, however, remains to be seen.
Yeah, and Susan, I agree with you 100%. I think we are more likely than ever to see a federal privacy law move forward in this Congress for all the reasons you described. It's an interesting question, and I would pick up on Susan's point that if a warrant is otherwise required, then it ought not be permissible to get it sideways. However, what sometimes gets lost in the nuance of this is that there has, in fact, for decades, been in US law something called the third party doctrine, which says that if you provide information voluntarily to a third party, the government can obtain information from the third party without going through a warrant process. Now remember, of course, under the Fourth Amendment, warrants aren't always required. What's always required is reasonableness. A warrant is one way that the government demonstrates reasonableness in obtaining information. Other ways include things like exigent circumstances, and that's why you can have things like, you know, DUI stops where, you know, people are stopped and asked to do field sobriety tests without having specific probable cause. So there's exceptions to the warrant requirement. Setting that aside, even where the real issue we have is this third party doctrine, and that is what has been the basis for obtaining not just data in the sense of communications records or location records or things like that from mobile phones, but financial records, all kinds of records can be obtained by the government from a third party who's holding it. And in this digital and connected environment, third parties hold all of our data, really, right? I mean, whether it's our search requests, whether it's our mobile phone activity, whether it's our location information. And it raises an interesting set of questions. It's easy to see the potential for abuse by government, absolutely. It's also easy to see the value to government as we're seeing, you know, the FBI making arrests of the folks who stormed the Capitol building on January 6th based on things like their social media posts and probably other kinds of information that they obtained from either apps or cell phone providers or, you know, somebody else. We've certainly seen the Supreme Court struggle with this issue. A couple years ago in the Carpenter decision on obtaining cell phone location information, the Supreme Court did say that law enforcement needed a warrant in order to obtain 7 days or more of location information for cell phones, but they didn't do away with this third party doctrine. I think until we have further clarity, whether it's a federal privacy legislation, whether it's further clarity on Fourth Amendment law from the Supreme Court or others, the really important thing I think is around oversight. Are there mechanisms in each relevant government agency that provide regulations for how the data can be acquired, how it can be used, who can access it, how long it can be held, what constraints are put on it, what accountability exists, what independent oversight from an inspector general or somebody else exists to make sure that there aren't abuses, how are they corrected if there is one? Those kinds of things are the things that create a framework within which it can be possible for government to use that kind of data in ways that are constructive for national security and law enforcement purposes without becoming overreach. And what we have right now across the federal and state and local landscape is a really uneven patchwork with respect to the regulations and the oversight of those kinds of activities.
Thanks, April and Susan. That was a great question, and I'm hopeful that we'll come to an appropriate regulation at some point. I have another great question here, different topic. I teach high school seniors, 17 to 18 year old seniors at a low wealth majority minority school in a class I created that focuses on data security and media literacy. It's a social science perspective. What are three walkaway ideas or pieces of knowledge I should be sending them into the world with in relation to today's general topic? And I'm actually going to turn that into four. So I'll ask each of you to contribute one idea. And since April is just busy and is just now thinking about this, I'll start with Hamid and we'll go around.
Sure. Working with the vulnerable population and patients and things like that, I think that an important topic is that security and privacy is something that now we need population-wide education on, and everybody needs to be understand with the now we are getting already lots of SMSs here about fake COVID vaccines and registering, and elderly are receiving these messages because it's just the right time. They're being targeted for vaccines, so it's actually the perfect time to hit them with these kind of things. So it's obviously everybody is having smartphones and stuff like that nowadays. So I think HCI methods, usable privacy and security methods really need to be adopted for the masses. They're not kind of exclusive to the security and privacy community anymore.
So we need to educate broadly all high school seniors, for example, about these issues. Okay, Susan?
So a long time ago, I was working in a position, and I was applying for a job within that company, a different position. And they asked me to be on the search committee for the big area. And actually it was a university, so I'll be more explicit. And I said, but I'm applying for a related position. And they said, no, it's okay. We're asking you to be here and you're applying there. And my response was, I don't want to imagine the headline in the local newspaper that says person on search committee hires herself or something like that. And I've always used the measure of, I grew up in Manhattan, so of course, what's my local newspaper? Do I want to see whatever I'm doing right now appear as a headline in the New York Times? And if I hold my head in my hands, the answer is no. Information on the internet doesn't go away. It just doesn't go away. So if I was teaching high school students, I'd ask them, when you to think about. When you post a piece of information on Facebook or somewhere else, do you want that to be around in 5 years, in 10 years? If you're sure you don't mind, go ahead and do it. But if you have doubts, don't do it. Information doesn't disappear.
Great, okay, Avi.
Yeah, so I would say to them that when you're making a decision about whether to acquire or use an IoT device, don't just look at the features and the functionality and the benefits of it, but take security and privacy into consideration. For example, ask yourself, what is the worst that can happen if this device is compromised by my worst adversary? And if you're still okay with it, then go ahead by all means and use this device. But if you think the consequences would be unacceptable to you, then think twice about it and make an educated decision as opposed to just getting something that seems really cool.
Thanks, Abby. April?
Yeah, and I would, you know, I would comment on the media literacy piece of it, and particularly the impact of social media. You know, first, I think it's really important for, you know, to convey to the students, if you get the opportunity, that the awareness that the way that social media platforms earn money is by keeping their eyeballs on screen. And the way to keep that engagement is frequently through things that arouse emotion. The old saying is, if it enrages, it engages. And so helping your students understand that what's popping up, to think critically about what's popping up in their social media feed and why. That it's not just a question of what their friends have posted. There are algorithms that are generating content specifically intended to prompt an emotional response and keep them on screen, because that's how social media platforms maximize their advertising revenue. So starting from that piece of critical thinking, what's popping up in my feed and why? Does it seem like it's coming from a credible source? Does it seem like it's trying to prompt an emotional reaction? How can I pick apart what this is and see what it's trying to prompt me to think or do or say or believe? And I would say also, you know, to Hamid's terrific point about the need for really wide range in public education on these things. It's really useful, I think, maybe to know that there's lots of social science research documenting the fact that the more something is repeated, the more likely we are to believe it, and that we are all susceptible to misinformation and propaganda of all kinds, and that in fact, the people who are most susceptible to that, to believing fake news, if you will, tend to be older people. And so as your students are talking with their parents or their grandparents about what they're seeing and reposting on Facebook, you know, maybe helpful for the students to know that sometimes it's their parents and grandparents who are struggling the most with this, and they can be helpful in that regard in educating them about how these platforms work, what the traps are, and some of the ways to kind of disengage and think a little more critically about sources of information and the internet rabbit holes and what's coming up in recommender analytics.
Great advice, very good. All four very helpful for those high school students. Thanks. The next question is kind of similar in a way for the adults. What can an individual do to protect themselves from having excessive data being collected on them in their homes? And thus having more potential data to be stolen and used maliciously. So what can you do, Avi? What can people do to protect themselves?
Well, that's a great question, because we're seeing more and more devices are being used in the house that have access to personal information. And in fact, if you set up a smart house, I too have many smart devices in my house, you'll notice that there's a great temptation, and they facilitate you integrating them with each other, so that my Google Home in my kitchen, I can say, show me the front door, and my doorbell is connecting to it. And this happens even if the devices come from different manufacturers. And so when you're causing your devices to integrate together, then information about that these devices have is all being collected in the same place, or all is available from the same place. And there are various things that you can do. Unfortunately, you're going to have trade-offs between usability, convenience, and service, and security. So one thing you could do, for example, is set up a pseudonymous Google account that's not really you, just some name that you're using to set up an account, And then you could register your Nest thermostat through that Google account and your other devices, but it's never actually linked to you personally. So you're still going to have information about you that's all linked. And if someone were to ever tie that to you, which they might be able to based on your address, then you will have lost that. But at the very least, you can do some things to decouple your actual identity from the use of many of these devices. That said, it's very difficult to do this, and it's not going to be practical if you really want to use these devices, if you want to link them to payment systems and you want to link them to various accounts. I think you're going to have to really make the decision, am I someone that wants to use all these IoT devices or not, as opposed to can I use these devices and still protect all of my personal information?
Thanks, Javi. Yeah, good suggestions. But as you say, it's hard. Okay, here's another one, I think for Hamid. How do techniques like federated learning change the IoT landscape? As users become more savvy with respect to privacy, might vendors that apply privacy-preserving approaches, such as federated learning, have a market advantage over their competitors that apply the Hoover approach that Avi mentioned, which is a name often people use to refer to just sucking up all the data they can get their hands on. Could regulation nudge things in that direction towards privacy preserving techniques like federated learning?
Yeah, good question. I think a couple of companies have recently been selling privacy as one of their advantages, and definitely having a couple of these big players bringing in more privacy is a good thing, because also, as Avi said, there's this trend that all these platforms and ecosystems at the moment, they're trying to land grab and they're trying to force you to integrate more and more of the various devices that you have in your home with their platform. So at the moment I have 4 of the top 5 platforms in my home. So there's kind of quite a race between them to who can grab each device. The one thing here is that, of course, there's techniques which are running in the background, whether it's privacy preserving techniques like federated learning or use of trusted execution environments and methods like this. They can be helpful, but of course these come at a cost, because only big manufacturers that actually make an effort in providing these services, their updates and their underlying infrastructure and frameworks which are needed to run these services can afford them. This might be a good thing, because from what we saw in the lab, for example, we tested about, I don't know, tens of cameras. The cheaper the camera was, basically, this is like home monitoring cameras, home monitoring and child monitoring, this kind of device. The cheaper the device was, the more connection it was having with the servers all around the world. Because basically, they're financing or subsidizing the cost of the device with selling data. So I think, there's a lot to look into in the next few years in terms of buying the devices and regulation. This is not, I keep saying that to everybody, and I'm not in any way lawyer or anything like that. This is not a game that we can only solve by throwing more computing and resources and techniques at it. This space needs regulation and policies and strong enforcement of those regulations.
Great, thanks, Hamid. We're closing in on the end of time here, so I'm going to ask each of the panelists just to say 30 seconds, quick concluding remarks, starting with Susan.
So we're at a funny point where we're not with we don't have regulation yet and control of the information. And I expect we will be there within 5 years to a certain extent. And so where I stand is I think very carefully about what the value is to me of using a device before I share my information. I'll probably make different decisions once there's regulation that controls the use of that data, but right now that's where I sit.
Okay, Avi?
Let me strike an optimistic note. So if we look at the history of computer security, we started out with really insecure computers. Then there were a lot of security problems, and then computers got more secure. Mobile devices did even better. If you look at iOS sandboxing, for example, it's a better security model than we have on computers. And so the next stage is we're in the Wild West of IoT devices, but when the importance of security is realized by the manufacturers and the regulators, hopefully we can do even better than the mobile devices.
Awesome. April.
I think, you know, this is such a wide-ranging set of issues that for people who are somewhat interested but don't want to, you know, do a deep dive in this all the time, I would say pick the areas that you care about most. Look at whether or not you're most concerned about government surveillance, about surveillance in the workplace, surveillance in schools, misinformation on social media, the spread of propaganda. Pick what issues you care about most and really focus your energy there in trying to keep abreast of changes in technology, changes in policy, changes in law, and how you can influence those by reaching out directly to either your local, state, or national representatives on these things, because this is absolutely a time of real change in all of these areas. And there's a real opportunity to have a voice if these are things you care about.
Great, yeah. Awesome. Comment.
Briefly, it would be, as technologists, we also need to understand the user's needs. And I think for people who are working in this area in future, they should understand that the old school business models of just getting data and selling data and ads, we might be able to rethink those models. So it's critical to think about new ways of benefiting from these devices and the services that they offer.
Well, thank you, all four of you. It's been a fantastic and very interesting panel. And also thanks to the audience for submitting some really interesting, meaty questions. And thanks to ISTS, the Institute for Security, Technology, and Society at Dartmouth, for convening and hosting this. If you're interested, I put in the chat a link to their homepage so you can find out more about their activities, including previous and upcoming events like this one. So thanks, everybody. Be safe. Have a good week. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much.